Welcome to the launch of a new book. This is Forbidden, Receiving Pope Francis's Condemnation of Nuclear Weapons. And Georgetown University Press, to whom I'm so grateful, has been a faithful partner, both on this book, and it was just published this month, and on its predecessor, A World Free from Nuclear Weapons, the Vatican Conference on Disarmament, published in 2020. The 2020 book was a second place winner from the Catholic Media Association in a category for morality and ethics. And Father Drew was very delighted about that. This one, new one, is the final book by the Reverend Drew Christiansen, SJ, and it contains tributes from the contributors to him. So I really hope if you get a moment to look at and see that tribute that we all wrote in honor of him at the beginning of the book. Father Christiansen was a senior fellow at the Berkley Center. He was the former editor-in-chief of America, the Jesuit Review. And among other gifts, he was an expert. He actually had a lot of areas he was interested in, but expert on nuclear disarmament, nonviolence, and just peacemaking. And I'm Carole Sargent, and this book arose from my role as director of the Office of Scholarly Publications at Georgetown. I was a writer. I was focusing on Roman Catholic sisters participating in nuclear disarmament activism. I'm also an associate of the RSCJ, the Society of the Sacred Heart, and that's how we began working together. The book grew out of a historic 2017 conference in Rome when Pope Francis became the first pope in the nuclear era to condemn both the use and the possession of nuclear weapons. Previous pontiffs had certainly not been pro-nuke, but they had nominally, albeit reluctantly, accepted deterrence as a necessity of the status of the Cold War in their time. You know, it was different times then. Times have changed. Father Drew Christiansen advised the Holy See on disarmament. He was always clear with me. He said, do not say that I wrote, say that I advised, and was on their delegation that participated in the negotiation of the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons in the summer of 2017. He oversaw both books. They were his babies. This was his vision developed with Archbishop Tomasi, and I was privileged to be a co-editor and contributor. I think that some of his finest work is in these two books, but especially two visionary chapters, one on conscience. One is pastoral accompaniment, Francis's approach to the human vocation. And the other one of my personal favorites, is in the chain of command, about what you do if you are actually asked to fire a weapon. Today's presentation is going to feature a very special guest. We have opening remarks by Archbishop John C. Wester of Santa Fe, New Mexico. We are then going to hear from contributors to the book, Dr. Marianne Cusimano Love and Kelsey Davenport, and a Jesuit professor who has published on disarmament issues, Father David Hollenbach. We also welcome in the audience, some of the contributors to the book are in the audience, Dr. Jerry Powers of Notre Dame, Daniel Hall of the Buddhist group Soka Gakkai, Dr. James O'Sullivan of St. Joseph's University, and I believe there are others. So if I missed you, would you please DM me and I will add you at the end, because we do want to greet all of the contributors to the book. Finally, there will be a moderated Q&A. So I encourage you to think about your questions as you listen, and I'll be moderating, and I believe they've already asked you this, but I'll ask you too. When you ask a question, I'll see your name, but if you would also please give me a little tagline of who you are so that we can contextualize your question for this exciting conversation. So on January 11th of 2022, the Most Reverend John C. Wester, who is Archbishop of Santa Fe, published an important pastoral letter. The letter was Living in the Light of Christ's Peace, a conversation toward nuclear disarmament. We are so grateful that he will open our dialogue today with his thoughts about further steps since the publication of that historic document.
Thank you very much, Carole. I'm very grateful to you, and thank you for that wonderful tribute to Father Christiansen. I can't thank you enough. I know I speak on behalf of all of us and so many more for that wonderful, wonderful book. It's just excellent. It's just superb. And so thank you very, very much. And thank you, everybody. I'm very honored and very humbled to be a part of this wonderful event this morning or this afternoon for some. And I'm grateful to you for allowing me to just say a few words. I'm grateful for this opportunity, and I'm also grateful for the pastoral letter. There was a team effort. I'm just so grateful to all the writers and my team, Mr. Jay Coughlin, who's the director of Nuke Watch New Mexico here in New Mexico, and Father John Deere and my staff here, Leslie and Ann. It was a wonderful, I think, providential work, really. And I think I see the hand of the Lord in it, and I pray that it will continue to be helpful going forward, giving each other hope. And I'm also pleased to say that the letter now has been translated into 5 languages, English, of course, and Japanese, Korean, Spanish, and Italian. So we've been pleased to present the letter to the Pope in English and in Spanish and shortly in Italian. So he's going to think I'm a pest, but I think it's important to have it available to the Vatican. And of course, we send a copy to President Biden and other legislators. It's important, of course, for us, all of us, to be doing all we can to protect our small world. The 5 languages reminds us that it is a small world after all. And it's the only world we have, and we need to protect it from nuclear annihilation. You will remember that 40 years ago, in 1983, the bishops of the United States published their well-known pastoral letter, The Challenge of Peace, God's Promise and Our Response. And in that letter, it did provide for deterrence. But we know now that the narrative of deterrence has really never been the only narrative. The United States and other nations have always had first strike strategies and capabilities. If it was simply deterrence, then we'd only have 100 or so weapons instead of the 13,000 plus weapons we have in the world now. So, but it was nonetheless a very important letter, and I'm not faulting it in any way. It was a letter of its time, and it was critically important and very significant, and it garnered a lot of attention. But since then, Pope Francis has been incredibly remarkable in his pronouncements. In 2017, as you know, he said that even the possession of nuclear weapons is to be condemned. And then in 2019, he reiterated that and said further that the mere possession of nuclear weapons is immoral. And then repeated that again in 2020 on the 75th anniversary of the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So I think that given these pronouncements from the church and the absolutely horrifying destructiveness of these nuclear weapons today in our world, and given the new arms race that we're now in that is arguably far more dangerous than the first, especially with the advent of hypersonic delivery systems and artificial intelligence, and given the element of human error, terrorism, miscommunications, and the fact that we've pushed our luck well beyond any reasonable limit, and given the geopolitical world landscape today and the devastating and unprovoked attack on Ukraine by Russia, and given the gospel of Jesus Christ, a gospel rooted in love and a peace that the world desperately needs today, given all this and so much more, there's clearly a moral imperative for human beings to respond to this most pressing and urgent pro-life cause, an urgent worldwide conversation that leads to peace through nuclear disarmament. Whether we like it or not, in 1945, the human race entered the nuclear age, assuming godlike prerogatives that put in the hands of fallible mortals the power to destroy all of civilization and put an end to God's marvelous and ever new creation. We must intervene immediately, decisively, and inexorably to put an end to this madness. If not us, then who? If not now, then when? And that's why I'm so grateful to all of you today in Georgetown for this marvelous seminar, and to Carol, and God rest Father Drew, for that remarkable book. This represents, I think, the work of so many in this very critical cause. It is my profound hope that together we can succeed and that we can bequeath to future generations a nuclear-free world. We must engage, I think, especially on our young people. For our young people in the world today, the 1962 Cuban Missile Crisis is only a footnote in history. But that footnote came precariously close to Armageddon. What first galvanized my attention, frankly, was when I was 12 years old in 1962, coming home from school and wondering if the planes overhead had Russian markings on them. Our parents tried to shield us from the fear that we all experienced then, but You know how kids are. We kind of wormed our way into it a little bit. So that was my connection. And then visiting Japan, and because Santa Fe is where the bomb was first created and deployed, I felt that there was a real important connection for us in Santa Fe to be involved in this vital conversation. But I think all of us have to examine, what is our connection with this cause? What, how does it, how do I connect to it? What are the reasons that I'm involved in it? And then for us to bring that to a conversation with others. I know that it's, what do they say? You're kind of like a skunk at a lawn party. Nobody wants to talk about it. Nobody likes to talk about difficult things. It's a complex issue. And who wants to talk about possible destruction of civilization? I mean, it's a very difficult issue. But remember that famous book by Scott Peck, The Road Less Traveled. The first sentence was three words: life is difficult, period. And then all of our neuroses come about to kind of avoid that reality. We mustn't avoid this reality. We have to sacrifice. We have to give of ourselves for this cause because it's worthwhile. And frankly, it is a real pro-life issue, the life of all of us on Mother Earth. For our part here in Santa Fe, just to let you know in conclusion, a group of us are planning a trip to Japan this August. And again, we've been invited to attend in 2025 for the 80th commemoration of the bombings in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And we're hoping that while there, we can work with the other bishops in Archbishop of Nagasaki and the Bishop of Hiroshima to establish Santa Fe, Hiroshima, and Nagasaki as sister dioceses, working together to promote peace and worldwide verifiable nuclear disarmament. Pope Francis has been bold in his statements about nuclear arms and about our care for our common home. We must be no less bold. I pray that this webinar and many like it will spark new and ever more extensive conversations that lead to a world living in peace and free from the threat of nuclear weapons. Thank you all very, very much. And I'm so grateful for this opportunity. And I turn it back to you, Carol.
Excellent. Thank you so much. And also, I noticed that joining us in the audience, I was naming the contributors to the book who are with us. We also have Professor William Barbieri from Catholic University and Professor Pierce Corden, and they both contributed, and Pierce Corden contributed two chapters. Now we'll turn to Dr. Marianne Cusimano-Love, who contributed two chapters, one on just peace and nuclear disarmament, and one on the ethics of nuclear stewards. Dr. Cusimano-Love is Associate Professor of Politics at the Catholic University of America, and she's a best-selling author. She has 13 books. She has served on Pope Francis's Security Task Force, on the board of directors of the Arms Control Association, on advisory boards for the U.S. Catholic Bishops International Justice and Peace Committee, and on the Catholic Peace Building Network, among many other things. She was also previously part of the core group of the State Department's Working Group on Religion and Foreign Policy. Marianne.
Thank you, Carol. Thank you, Archbishop Wester, for your wonderful work that continues to stir dialogue and conversation, and for all of us who are joining us to be part of this conversation. 10 years ago today, we had a big conference, a several day conference, international conference at Catholic University of America to mark the anniversary of the Pacem in Terris encyclical, as well as the bishop's challenge of peace letter. And Drew Christiansen gave the keynote remarks at the conference. We had many different cardinals and members of the church and non-governmental actors there. And it was a time of great optimism. Pope Francis had newly been elected Pope. There was some momentum from getting the New START treaty passed. And we talked at that point of how we could kind of continue this momentum. And it's such a pleasure to see this book come out, which was the result of many of our efforts to continue the momentum from that dialogue and have a larger discussion. If you're interested in knowing more, you can look at the Catholic Peacebuilding Network website, where we have materials about our student dialogues, the number of conferences, et cetera, that we've had, reports, and ways in which you can become involved in this effort to expand the dialogue and discussion about reducing the nuclear dangers. My two chapters to the book really address two different aspects of a similar argument. Many of those who are arguing in favor of continuing the nuclear status quo, continuing the large arsenals that we have now, and continuing to rely on nuclear deterrence as a main portion of defense strategy, rely on two arguments. Those who argue for the status quo are arguing that the current levels of nuclear weapons that we have are safe, and that that's the best we can do. There's really no other way to try to have a peaceful world. And my two chapters, they really contest both of those arguments. The first one, that the level of nuclear weapons that we have today is safe, and that we can safely hold these large arsenals, is not documented by the facts. There have been many, many nuclear accidents and nuclear near misses. We heard from Archbishop Wester, of course, about the Cuban Missile Crisis, but there were many, many other experiences during the Cold War up until the present day, where we had some very grave risks posed by simply the possession of the nuclear weapons. There was a series of scandals in the units that are responsible for controlling the nuclear weapons and keeping them safe. And this is described in my chapter, The Ethics of Nuclear Stewards, in which the units charged with US nuclear weapons, responsibilities for US nuclear weapons were decommissioned, where the leaders of those units were fired for malfeasance, incompetence, and dereliction of duty. Some of those concerns were that the leadership, that there was a widespread cheating scandal among those charged with holding nuclear weapons, that they were not keeping up with what they needed to know about how to have those how to keep those weapons safe, and instead were cheating and spreading the answers to the other units in order to meet the minimum requirements for those units. There were also a number of near misses where the weapons were moved without knowledge of the units. So they thought they had been moving conventional weapons and leaving them unguarded on runways for several days when there were actually just nuclear weapons on those planes and no one was aware of that. Additionally, some of the leadership was involved in scandals ranging from illegal gambling to one of them, one of the officers in charge of nuclear weapons was representing the US government in the US-Russian Federation nuclear weapons security exercise. So he was at a nuclear weapons security exercise in Russia, and he was drunk and disorderly. So also one of the units was charged and court-martialed. Many of the members were court-martialed for selling LSD, cocaine, marijuana, distributing drugs, as well as using drugs. So these are just a few. There's many more documented in that chapter that contest this idea that the weapons that we have now are safe, that we're keeping up with them safely. And in the words of one of the lieutenant colonel who took action against these officers, he described in his words that there was widespread, quote, rot, R-O-T, rot in the crew force, which has led to his recommendation to recommission some of those units and dismiss those officers. So that calls into question that idea that the number of weapons we have today are safe and that we are keeping up with them safely, which is one of the reasons Pope Francis has led to this conclusion that it's immoral to possess nuclear weapons due to the clear and present danger. The numbers of these weapons that we have today are not really fully safe. The second argument, though, is that we need these weapons because it's really the best we can do, that having this balance of terror, having these weapons at hair triggers alert pointed at one another is the only way to maintain some safety and security in our world. And that also is really contested by the facts. We have a lot of experience, and particularly in the decades since the US bishops' peace pastoral was written, we have lots and lots of experience of building peace around the world, and particularly Catholic and religious actors being very active in building peace in what were once thought just hopeless war zones. So areas from Northern Ireland, they're now celebrating the 25th anniversary of the Good Friday Peace Accords, to Colombia and the Philippines, that have peace accords and working on implementation of those accords, to many other areas around the world, and particularly, of course, the Velvet Revolutions that brought about the end of the Soviet Empire in Eastern Europe, we have a lot of experience of how we can effectively build peace, not based on this kind of balance of terror. And the ways in which we do that, there's several principles and associated practices, which I discuss in my chapter on just peace and nuclear weapons, which allow us to build a stronger peace based on right relationships. And those criteria are participation, restoration, right relationship, reconciliation, and sustainability. So what do we need to do around these criteria, these moral principles? What types of practices can we do that will lead us to deeper levels of nuclear disarmament? With regard to participation, I've worked with Drew Christiansen and others. We were consultants to the UN mission of the Holy See at New York, and we took part in the discussions to ban nuclear weapons. It's now our latest treaty, the Treaty to Prohibit Nuclear Weapons. And those processes were quite unique in that they were the first time that those who had been harmed by nuclear weapons were allowed to have a voice and participate in those discussions at the United Nations in New York. We heard from the victims of nuclear weapons, the victims of nuclear testing, and those around the world from our own Southwest, our Native American populations who've been so harmed, as Bishop Wester discusses in his letter, who've been so harmed by the possession and testing of those weapons in the US Southwest, to people in Kazakhstan who have been under nuclear bombs during the Soviet era, as well as, of course, to our brothers and sisters in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Nagasaki, of course, was the head of the Catholic Church in Asia when it was bombed. So the Catholic Church, we ourselves were victims of those nuclear explosions, and then were the very first responders to reach out. Those who survived the blast at the Nagasaki Cathedral were those who reached out to help others. So the Catholic Church speaks on these issues with great credibility and legitimacy. We've been part of this discussion about ridding the world of nuclear weapons since they were first dropped upon us. And as we've held that we need to move towards deeper disarmament. So one is that you can expand participation. And we have new ways in which we can get new participants to the table. One that I mentioned was that process through the ban treaty. The Treaty to Prohibit Nuclear Weapons will be meeting again this summer in New York City. And this leaves a great opportunity to hear from the voices of people in countries that have been harmed by nuclear weapons. We also have new mechanisms to hear the voices of women at the table who've been excluded across these decades where nuclear arms discussions were had about us, without us. And so we have new UN Security Council resolutions that require greater inclusion of women's voices at the table, and that can lead to new ways of looking at these issues and different outcomes. By expanding participation, you are expanding the constituents for peace. So it's important to do that, not just kind of some PC idea that the optics will be better with different people around the table, but that you're getting different voices, different perspectives that will lead to different opportunities and different policies around the nuclear weapons complex. The second component of restoration, again, the TPNW is the first nuclear weapons treaty to discuss how to have economic restoration, how to have environmental restoration, how to have restoration of human health that has been harmed by the weapons, the things that were discussed in Archbishop Wester's letter that they need to have economic transformation in New Mexico in order to wean the community from these nuclear weapons complex. That is provided for in the treaty. Those discussions that I mentioned at the UN this summer will be about how to make those elements of the treaty more robust. The United States should participate in those discussions at the UN in this summer. The US has a good record to discuss in terms of actions we are taking to clean up the environment, to clean up areas that have been harmed by nuclear weapons. The Biden administration in the Infrastructure Act includes money for cleaning up of these sites that have been received the environmental and health impacts from nuclear weapons. So we should participate in these discussions of restoration in order to bring our good news to the table and expand those constituents for peace. that addresses the concern of right relationship, that rather than the nuclear have states having all the power and all the decision-making about the fate of nuclear weapons, that we need to enter into right relationship with those who've been harmed by nuclear weapons, as well as the countries that don't have nuclear weapons. Many Catholic countries have been leading the charge for deeper nuclear disarmament. They have been the ones leading the discussions for the nuclear weapons-free zones. Our colleagues and brothers and sisters in the church throughout Latin America and Ireland have been leading voices for leading the world to lower levels of nuclear arms, and we need to be in right relationship with them as well. Reconciliation is often seen as kind of the most difficult of the just peace criteria. People often think unless it's full forgiveness and a kind of a kumbaya moment that you can't have reconciliation. But reconciliation includes really important things like truth telling and public acknowledgement. And we have many greater opportunities today, given new technologies and given the rising power of civil society, to have new mechanisms for transparency and verifiability of nuclear weapons agreements, as well as ways to move the world towards deeper nuclear disarmament. We've seen models with the Landmines Treaty, with the Cluster Munitions Treaty, where civil society groups play an important role in monitoring nuclear policy and monitoring arms control. And we could see greater participation of civil society monitoring and having greater transparency in the nuclear arms arena as well. And private sector actors have access to satellite technology, things that in the past had only been the realm of states. That leads us to the last criteria of sustainability. Unless we build these deeper relationships, we won't have a peace that is sustainable. And so these efforts to expand the constituents for peace, to expand the activities of the private sector, whether it's civil society, religious groups or others, to expand our relationships also with Russia, because when this war with Ukraine ends, we will still have to renew and revive our relationships with Russia, that these are the ways to a stronger, more sustainable peace, one that is not reliant on this balance of terror with the very high levels of nuclear arms that we have today. So I invite you to read the rest of the book, and I'm looking forward to hearing from some of our other contributors. Back to you, Carol.
That's wonderful. And I also enjoyed hearing Dr. Kuzumana Love speak at Catholic University yesterday. So 2 days in a row, it's been great. Now, Reverend David Hollenbach, S.J., is the Pedro Rupe Distinguished Research Professor in the Walsh School of Foreign Service. Father Hollenbach is a senior fellow at the Berkley Center, and he's an affiliated professor in the Department of Theology and Religious Studies at Georgetown University. And we will hear from him.
Thank you very much, Carol, and thanks to the other participants in our conference. I'm looking forward to our conversation and our discussion as this evolves. I thought it would be useful for me to highlight some developments that have taken place since the U.S. Bishop's pastoral letter on the challenge of peace, which took place back in, was issued back in 1983, which had made some very strong analysis of the status of nuclear weapons then. At the time that the bishops issued that document, they said that the possession of nuclear weapons could be legitimate as a step on the way to disarmament. And the current position taken by Pope Francis is quite different from that, it seems to me, in which he is arguing that the possession of nuclear weapons is not legitimate and is not legitimate for purposes of deterrence. One of the issues that it seems to me that's useful here is to bring to the fore the recent discussions about the use of the norms of just war tradition in analysis of the nuclear question. As many of you know, there has been a significant debate within the Roman Catholic community in recent years about the viability of the just war tradition. The commitment of Christians to pursue nonviolent means of conflict resolution and to pursue nonviolence as a response to the call of Jesus to be peacemakers and to turn the other cheek and so forth. And that raises the question about the relevance of the just war norms today. And those norms were applied by the US bishops back in 1983 to analyze the nuclear question. Now, Pope Francis has said, for example, in his encyclical Fratelli Tutti, that it is very difficult, he says, nowadays to invoke the rational criteria elaborated in earlier centuries speaking about the possibility of a just war. He says it's very difficult there. And he also said in his 1917 World Day of Peace message that nonviolence should become the hallmark of our decisions. This raises the question then about whether or not the rejection of the possession of nuclear weapons is really done for reasons of saying that Christian commitment in any kind of war is illegitimate. It seems to me that Pope Francis is not actually saying that the just war tradition and the norms that are part of it have been are to be altogether rejected. For example, on the plane when he was returning to Rome from Kazakhstan very recently, just about a year ago, he was asked about the relevance of the just war tradition for whether it was legitimate for the Ukrainians to defend themselves against the Russian attack in Ukraine today. And he responded this way. He said, "This is a political decision which can be moral if it's done according to the conditions of morality." And this seems to me, he says, I think he's saying, when he says it's done according to the conditions of morality, is referring to the conditions of just war norms. And therefore, he went further in his statement on the plane coming back from Kazakhstan to say, we need to think more about the concept of just war. My view on this would be to say that this is his position is similar to that of the American bishops that basically said back in their 1993 statement, "The harvest of justice is sown in peace," that our constant commitment should be to pursue justice through nonviolent means, but that it could be legitimate for political authorities to resort to force if it's the last resort, done in a limited way, to rescue the innocent and to reestablish justice. Now, the question then emerges, and that's what I'm suggesting here is that what we're seeing is a very stringent interpretation of the just war norms in recent discussions by Pope Francis. Very stringent. The just war tradition should be called the just and unjust war tradition. It's about as much about the injustice as it is about the justice of the use of force. And it means that the use of force could be most often seen as unacceptable from the point of view of a moral assessment. Now that leads us then to the question about what does that imply about nuclear weapons? It seems to me that Pope Francis's position that says that the possession of nuclear weapons is unacceptable is similar in some ways to the call by former major political leaders in the United States, a number of statements jointly issued by George Shultz, former Secretary of State, William Perry, former Secretary of Defense, Henry Kissinger, former Secretary of State, and Sam Nunn, head of the Senate Armed Forces Committee. It was they have issued a number of statements jointly in which they've said that what we need to do is to move to a world free of nuclear weapons. They call for this because they say the dangers of nuclear weapons are much greater today than they were somewhat back in the years when the bishops were writing their 1983 pastoral letter, Challenge of Peace. They cite, for example, the dangers arising from North Korea's possession of nuclear weapons, the dangers arising from Iran's possession of nuclear weapons, the danger that nuclear weapons could fall into the hands of terrorist organizations. And one could add to that something that goes beyond what these leaders have said recently, the dangers of Russia's threats to use tactical nuclear weapons in a regional conflict like that in Ukraine. So this opens the door then to say, where do we stand on the possession of nuclear weapons? Does it mean, is the position being advocated by Pope Francis the same as that being advocated back 25 years ago by John Finnis, Joseph Boyle, and Germaine Grisey, who argued that we need to unilaterally disarm from nuclear weapons, even if it leads to very dangerous consequences. They took a very strong position on this, and they wanted to say that there's an obligation to disarm immediately today, even no matter what the consequences might be. I think that that goes a little bit beyond what Pope Francis is suggesting. I would like to suggest, following what Drew Christiansen has said, that we need to see the challenge of nuclear weapons today and the immorality of continuing to possess them as a call to pursue prudent methods of abolition. This leads to the conclusion that I think what Pope Francis is recommending is similar to what Pope John Paul, Pope John the 23rd, and Pope Francis have both called integral disarmament. This means a broad range of steps that seek the gradual transformation of the political, social, and economic conditions of our world in a way that leads us able to move away from the possession and reliance on nuclear weapons. What Secretary Schultz and Kissinger and so forth have suggested is that this means moving toward the reduction of the size of our nuclear forces, eliminating the use of the reliance on short-range nuclear weapons, control on the production of these weapons, and work to resolve the regional conflicts that encourage the rise of new nuclear powers. And I would also suggest that it means following what Jerry Powers has said when he's described integral disarmament as seeing the need for a positive form of peace building, a form of positive peace and not just negative avoidance of war, which means moving toward greater socioeconomic development that reduces the threat to use weapons and the greater respect for human rights, the strengthening of international norms and institutions, and the growth in a spirit of dialogue. All of these are some of the steps that need to accompany the movement toward the elimination of the nuclear weapons. So that's what I would call, and what I think Pope Francis is calling, integral disarmament, rather than disarmament simply as focusing on the possession of the weapons themselves. So that would be my proposal about the way in which we should be moving forward on abolishing nuclear weapons. Thanks very much.
Excellent. Thank you so much. And before our next speaker, I do have a favor to ask of our audience today. And that is that if you would begin to share your questions now in the Q&A, as you listen to our speakers, that will give me time to go through the questions and perhaps even chat with the speaker on a sidebar to make sure that we're ready to go on your question. I will be able to see your name, but if relevant, please also identify your organization and your specific role if those are relevant to the conversation we're having today. Next, we will have Kelsey Davenport, and she contributed a chapter, Reviving Disarmament Education, to the book we're discussing today. And for those who joined late, the book is Forbidden, Receiving Pope Francis's Condemnation of Nuclear Weapons from Georgetown University Press. Kelsey Davenport is the Herbert Scoville Jr. Peace Fellow at the Arms Control Association, and she is its director for nonproliferation policy, focusing on the nuclear and missile programs in Iran, North Korea, India, and Pakistan. Kelsey Davenport reports for Arms Control Today and runs the Arms Control Association's project assessing the effectiveness of multilateral voluntary initiatives that contribute to non-proliferation efforts.
Thank you, Carol. It's a real honor for me to be here today and join this panel, and even more of an honor to have the opportunity to contribute a chapter to Forbidden. I certainly benefited from Father Drew's work in the nuclear policy space, and it's hard to think of a better way to honor his legacy than this book. So I do hope those of you online will look it up, because it really is quite a critical collection. So in the policy space where I work, you know, both in the United States and in international forums, you know, nuclear weapons related discussions are focused primarily still on security dynamics. And they're largely discussed in a language, you know, using terms like deterrence, strategic stability, that make public engagement, you know, much more challenging. And questions surrounding the ethics and the morality of possessing nuclear weapons and using nuclear weapons, you really are not as prevalent as they should be in nuclear policy debates, and I think not as prevalent as they have been in past decades. You know, the treaty that Marianne mentioned in her remarks, the TPNW, you know, that is engaging impacted communities and looking at some of these questions about you know, restoration of right relationship. But unfortunately, I think that's still the exception. That's not the norm for these nuclear policy debates. And to be honest, I think the security-based focus is largely intentional. I mean, siloing nuclear weapons as a security issue, you know, creates an exclusionary dynamic that deters broader engagement, and I think prevents us from as effectively challenging the narratives that nuclear weapons are necessary to our security that are still so prevalent in these policy spaces. And that's one reason why I think, you know, this collection in Forbidden really is critically important, because Pope Francis's condemnation of nuclear weapons and the documents and discussions that have come out of the November 2017 conference, I think, open the door and give us more tools to re-examine and reinvigorate nuclear policy debates, looking at them through a moral lens. And I think this really can be beneficial if we try to move forward in creating a more inclusive and holistic discussion about the role that nuclear weapons plays and the consequences of maintaining these systems, you know, defining them as necessary to national security. So in my contribution to the book, you know, as Carol noted, which is on reviving disarmament education, you know, I want to pull today on sort of two aspects of that chapter that I think could be useful as we think about trying to advance education and trying to advance public engagement in nuclear disarmament going forward. And the first point I want to raise is that when teaching about nuclear weapons, when trying to advance nuclear disarmament in the public space, we need to pursue nuclear disarmament with a more authentic intersectionality. And I think this is critical because the threat posed by nuclear weapons is not as salient today for post-Cold War generations that didn't grow up with, you know, duck and cover, the concepts of mutually assured destruction. The nuclear weapons threat remains, I think, very abstract. As I think, you know, others have said, it's sort of relegated to history, things like the Cuban Missile Crisis. And I opened my chapter actually with a quote from Kofi Annan that I think really captures some of the sentiment today. You know, he notes that, you know, while it's positive that these generations are not growing up under the threat of nuclear weapons, you know, ignorance, you know, leads to complacency. And, you know, to quote him directly, he says, you know, what we know little about, we care to do anything about, you know, end quote. And I think absent, you know, any nuclear weapons use, absent, you know, a near catastrophe, you know, this sentiment is going to continue to grow, where nuclear weapons just feel less salient, the threat, you know, feels, you know, abstract. But if we look at, you know, the post-Cold War generations, you know, the existential threats that motivate them now, you know, really come from their lived experience. So particularly if they see an effect on their local communities. You know, those are the risks posed by climate change, you know, by terrorism, by racial injustice, you know, cyber issues. You know, these are much more proximate, you know, to these generations. And these, because they see the effect, you know, it's these issues that are motivating them to take action. And this is one reason why I think, you know, the Pope's teaching and the documents from the November 2017 conference, you know, are so important. Because Pope Francis reminds us that nuclear weapons are connected to these issues and puts these connections at the forefront of his discussion about why the possession of nuclear weapons, you know, is immoral. You know, for instance, he talks about environmental injustices from the production of nuclear weapons. the environmental devastation of nuclear weapons use, the consequences of for the environment of maintaining, you know, these arsenals. You know, in addition to that, you know, he also touches on, you know, the social justice and health components that come from maintaining these arsenals. You know, we've seen indigenous communities, the global south, you know, continuing to bear the brunt of the effects, you know, from nuclear testing, you know, uranium mining, and in large part, you know, also dealing with nuclear waste related issues. Also, you know, the points that are raised, you know, from the November 2017 conference about the funds that go into maintaining these arsenals, the opportunity costs that our society incurs by continuing to fund these, you know, continuing to fund the nuclear weapons enterprise, you know, is born, you know, in communities really worldwide. So by putting these issues and these connections kind of front and center in his condemnation of the possession of nuclear weapons and encouraging us to think about those moral aspects, yeah, I think that provides a very interesting window to revive disarmament education in a way that makes the nuclear threat seem more proximate and more salient, you know, to generations that didn't, you know, grow up really understanding these risks in the same way as those that experienced sort of those Cold War dynamics. And that by demonstrating these connections, you know, we might be able to inspire, you know, greater action and further challenge policymakers to look at nuclear weapons as more than just a security issue. So that was the first area that I wanted to talk about. And the second point that I would raise is that in trying to revive and advance disarmament education and advance nuclear disarmament itself, we have to demonstrate that disarmament is both desirable and achievable. And if we look at these two aspects, I think the desirability is widely understood. I mean, nuclear disarmament for the five, you know, recognized nuclear weapon states is a legal requirement. There's no dispute that, or really, you know, no real debate that they're obligated to disarm, you know, under the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. And if we look at the broader population, I mean, nuclear disarmament really is supported by majorities, you know, worldwide, regardless of whether you're in a nuclear weapon state or a non-nuclear weapon state. Nuclear disarmament is seen as desirable. I mean, in 2008, for instance, in a very large poll here in the United States, you know, 69% of respondents, you know, agreed with the statement that the world would be safer without nuclear weapons. Unfortunately, 84% of them that favored elimination didn't think nuclear disarmament or nuclear zero is actually possible because the knowledge of nuclear weapons will continue to exist. It's widespread. And they didn't see a path to actually eliminating those nuclear weapons. You know, related to that, you know, more recently, you know, there's some very interesting polling released in the Wall Street Journal, or sorry, in the Washington Post in 2019. That said that, you know, over half of Americans deliberately avoid reading about nuclear threats. And 76% prefer to think the idea that a nuclear catastrophe can never happen, in part because they don't see that viable pathway towards nuclear disarmament, because the challenge of disarmament feels so technically challenging, so difficult to move forward, that it just doesn't feel achievable. So if we move forward in nuclear disarmament education, and as we move forward trying to engage the public in disarmament, I think we need to balance, you know, the aspirational goal of eliminating nuclear weapons, you know, with tangible steps that reduce risk in the short term and demonstrate progress. We have to lay out the vision of how to get to nuclear disarmament. And we have to show people how these issues connect to their local communities where they may feel more empowered to act. And again, this is where I think, you know, using the moral and ethical lenses, the connections that Pope Francis draws upon in his condemnation of nuclear weapons, you know, provides more avenues for motivating that type of engagement. It provides more avenues to see how your own local community is affected, and how your own local community may be able to take action. It provides ideas going forward, again, about how to challenge the dominant narratives about the security value of nuclear weapons. And I think makes that path towards nuclear disarmament sort of appear more accessible and appear sort of more achievable. So again, I think if we can embed those measurable steps, you know, within that inspiring vision, you know, that can be very beneficial in advancing disarmament and thinking about how we pursue disarmament education in the future. So again, I just to conclude, I think that, you know, that Pope Francis's statement, his condemnation about the immorality of possessing nuclear weapons, you know, really provides a lot of avenues for us to make more authentic connections with some of the existential threats that are motivating younger generations today, and really provide some options moving forward to move us down that path towards nuclear disarmament. So thank you again so much for the opportunity to be here, and I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you, and now we'll go to the discussion, and we have some good questions. I do, since we just have 9 minutes for Q&A, it's a little shorter than I meant. I'm hoping that we can address all of these. There are three really solid questions here. One is from Jane Malhotra, and she is the editor of Georgetown Health Magazine. And she says, would you say there is a dotted line connection, and this is for any of our panelists, between nuclear disarmament and a reduction in assault style weapons among citizens in the US? And of course, we had a tragedy this week. Can we apply some of the same principles of nonviolence and right relationship domestically? And I immediately thought of Marianne with this, but it can go to any of our panelists.
Sorry, Carol, having trouble unmuting. I think so, because in both cases, the weapons are a symptom, right? And they're a symptom of something underlying, a deeper underlying problem. And so we need to get rid of the weapons as a means to not have greater destruction while we continue to deal with what are the underlying issues that are causing people to lash out in ways that that utilize those weapons. It goes back to what Kelsey was saying. Can we imagine a world that is achievable? What are the concrete steps we could take to create a world that would be achievable? And that is true both in the question of nuclear weapons. What are those concrete steps we can take to reduce our reliance on those weapons, even if we're not going to get to zero in our lifetimes? And similarly for assault style weapons, what are the concrete steps that can be taken? We're not going to remove all Americans' arms. We're the most armed state on planet Earth, but what are the concrete steps we can take to improve mental health, to address excess of weapons that are don't have any need for deer hunting? You don't need an assault rifle to hunt deer, those types of things.
And did anybody else have thoughts about it? Because we do have another question. This one is for, and tell me, by the way, if I skip over you and you had a thought, DM me, and then I'll weave you back in. This question is from Dan Moriarty. He's Senior Program Officer at the Marianal Office for Global Concerns. And he has a question directed to Father Hollenbach. Integral disarmament is a strong, helpful notion when it drives disarmament plus, doing real disarmament, but also embedding it in a broader program of peace building. The fear is that it becomes an excuse to do nothing until we can do everything. How can or does church teaching go beyond naming disarmament as an essential but eventual goal and move us to take concrete disarmament steps today?
Oh, that's a valuable question, and it's a very important question. It seems to me that what we're called upon here is to take immediate steps to try to reduce the dangers that we're facing in the world today because of the massive numbers of nuclear weapons that are around. And that means taking the non-proliferation treaty very seriously and really implementing it. Avoiding the kind of escalation of building new nuclear weapons that are being proposed today. There's a lot of proposal to move in that direction, and that the call of Pope Francis to say that the possession of these weapons is unacceptable is a call to avoid the kind of steps toward increasing the presence of these weapons among ourselves, among various countries, including the United States. It means also moving toward the elimination of short-range nuclear weapons, which are very dangerous, in some ways the most dangerous weapons at this point, because they're more easily imaginable to be useful. And that to find a way to reduce our reliance on those. So these are some of the steps, it seems to me, that can be taken right away toward this integral disarmament. And another component of this, of course, is finding ways to reduce the underlying tensions between both the great powers, but also the emerging powers in our world that tempt people to think they should rely or need to rely on nuclear weapons. Why do the Iranians think they need nuclear weapons? Why do the North Koreans think they need them? Why do the Pakistanis and the Indians think they need them? Well, there are economic pressures on these countries. There are pressures to say we need to become a significant force in the world. Can we not find a way to give these countries a sense that they're moving, that they can move forward in aspiring toward a greater level of greatness in their own countries without relying upon weapons of this sort? And that's another step in the area where reducing the tensions between countries that lead them to think they need weapons in order to become major forces in the world is a very important step. So it frames the whole thing in a way that helps us move forward a step at a time, it seems to me.
Excellent. And we have a question from Susan Gunn. And did Susan Gunn identify herself? I want to make sure that I got this. Anyway, she says, and I thought of Kelsey Davenport here, but of course, again, others can answer too. What did the speakers recommend that the USCCB do to demonstrate to US Catholics that disarmament is desirable and achievable? Oh, I'm sorry. It says she's Director, Mary Knoll, Office for Global Concerns.
Thank you so much. I think that there's a number of steps that the USCCB could do to try to motivate greater public engagement here in the United States and the Catholic community. You know, one area where the USCCB has been so helpful in the past is in recognizing that we need to have dialogue with authoritarian regimes with atrocious human rights records, in order to advance nuclear disarmament. And while distasteful, this is necessary. They were strong supporters of negotiations, with Russia on the New START treaty, for instance. They're strongly supportive of US negotiations with Iran on the Iran nuclear deal from 2015. And I think, unfortunately, in Washington right now, there is a growing sentiment that talks with these states somehow legitimizes them, that's a gift we give them rather than an important step that we have to take to reduce nuclear risk. So continuing that role in supporting the importance of dialogue is critical. But I also think the USCCB can do more to also try to disseminate the Pope's teaching and what came out of the November 2017 conference. I mean, I remember I had the privilege of being there, and I remember coming back and telling my mother and my grandmother about this. And they asked, well, when are we going to hear about this in our local churches? Mm-hmm. And I think encouraging dioceses across the country to, discuss the Pope's teaching, to discuss disarmament, that's a powerful way to reinvigorate interest. And that's a powerful way, again, to demonstrate the ties that local communities have to nuclear issues. I mean, Archbishop Wester, I mean, he lives in a community that's integrally tied to the US nuclear weapons enterprise. But, it's not just these immediate connections, living in a diocese where there are nuclear weapons labs, for instance. Across the country, there are air bases, where nuclear weapons are stored. There are, there are other national labs. There are, elements that have supported the nuclear weapons complex that have suffered because of the nuclear weapons complex. And I think in demonstrating that the church can be very powerful in demonstrating those ties and then promoting some of the national and local initiatives that really help, with those concrete steps towards disarmament, whether that's, expressing support for the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, for instance, whether that's trying to make communities nuclear free zones, I think the USCCB could play, you know, a really critical role in those local initiatives as well.
Excellent, thank you. And we are at time, it's 1 o'clock. For those who asked in the chat, the book is Forbidden, Receiving Pope Francis's Condemnation of Nuclear Weapons, published this month by Georgetown University Press. It's companion volume, A World Free from Nuclear Weapons, the Vatican Conference on Disarmament, was published in 2020, and this was the final book by Father Drew Christiansen, SJ, who passed away in April a year ago. So we're commemorating him and this work this day. There were excellent questions that came in late, and I'm sorry I didn't get to acknowledge you all. They were just wonderful. But I want to thank our panelists and the Berkley Center for an amazing conversation. And if you'd like to continue that conversation, there will be more events surrounding the book. Drop me a note, and I can make sure you get on a mailing list for future events connected to Forbidden.